Okay, this is now something completely different. It's about the estimation of the South African extreme wind statistics, which is imperative, you know, when you do a design of a wind farm. And my partner there is Charlie Larsen of the Danish Technical University of Wind Energy. And what we are going to cover is just like a background of the small wind cloud of South Africa, the necessity of the extreme wind statistics, and then your approaches to extreme wind estimation, the measured data which should form the basis, and then the modeling, you know, to increase the resolution of your outputs. And then I will show you some of the WASA 1 results and also the WASA 2 progress. And now if you look at the origins of the strong winds in South Africa, we all know that the interior strong winds are dominated by thunderstorms, and there you can see on those maps there, on the left hand side, the primary causes, that grey area there is where South Africa is dominated by thunderstorms. And the map just underneath it is where there's a strong influence of extratropical cyclones or cold fronts. Then on the right hand side you can see a secondary causes. For example, that left at the top is the ridging in of high pressure systems. We all know that in the southwestern Cape you get strong southeasterly winds and also get an inflow of moisture at the north, you know, from the Indian Ocean. The others are, for example, isolated low pressure systems and troughs where you get an inflow of air, and that is like a precursor to the for thunderstorms to develop. Now, these extreme wind statistics are necessary because you have to fulfill the IEC 61401 site assessment rules. You have a checklist for your turbine classification, your extreme winds, that's what we are busy with, turbulence intensity, vertical wind shear, flow inclination, and your wake turbulence. And for that, you have to apply appropriate software, for example, WASP Engineering, that is developed by DTU. And then your inputs would be, for example, your extreme wind statistics, which is the most important. Then your information of the wind farm, for example, the arrangement of your wind turbines. And then also the environment around the proposed wind farm, for example, what is important that influences the wind speed is your surface roughness, your topography, and your obstacles. So then you start going through your checklist, and from that, from your calculations, from your software, you can then decide, okay, which wind turbine class is the most appropriate for your wind farm. Then the next is, if we just go through how we did the estimation of the extreme wind statistics. First of all, what we did was the analysis of the measured data. And if you can see there, first of all, we did a background study. We looked at the prevailing macroclimatic conditions. We studied extreme value theory, all the statistical methods and so on. But we also look at infrequent met events, for example, things like tornadoes and tropical cyclones and so on. Then we investigate the available wind data. You have to do an audit and you have to do quality control of wind data because you are working with wind gust data that is prone to outliers and so on. And sometimes there's instrument problems that you need to address. Then you do a description of the strong wind climate. You look at the different causes of these strong winds, because that will determine what kind of statistical analysis to apply. Then we analyze the wind data with the different methods. We did the ordinary general extreme value method, peak over threshold method, and then a mixed distribution method where we took into account the mix from the climate. Then what's very important is the investigation of the exposure of the weather stations. We assess the exposure of the weather stations, and then we also develop correction factors. And then eventually we developed our extreme wind climatology from our measured data. But the selection of your 1 in 50 quantiles, the interpolation of those results, and then looking at the uncertainty of your quantiles because you have different periods of data that you work with, and eventually we develop the maps. Then this is for WASA 1, the 10-minute map from the measured data, and all these values are compatible with the mixed strong wind climates that we find by using the appropriate techniques. But as you can see, it's a very low resolution. So the planned wind farms in the remote areas are not sufficiently covered by the long-term measurements that the weather service is providing. That is the 1 in 50 year 10-minute wind speed for the project area. Now for modeling, we know that a much higher spatial resolution is possible, and we also are aware that new methods are continuously researched, but the biggest obstacle is to take your low time resolution data, for example 6-hour wind speeds, and to convert that to high time resolution statistics. You must calculate, for example, a 1 in 50 a 10 minute for a gust wind speed. So the problem there is that the temporal variability can be missed out by smoothing the effect of the numerical modeling. So a method that is widely used and that we also apply primarily is what we call the selective dynamical downscaling method. And the first step was to identify your annual maximum storms. And then we did mesoscale modeling of those storms. And we run a WAF model for two domains, for 72 and 175 cases. The input was the CFSR data at the 6-hour time resolution. From 1998 to 2010, 22nd time stage foot, 41 vertical layers, and a runtime of about 72 hours or a little bit less per storm. The output was a 4 kilometer resolution, and the output was in 10 minutes. Then we used the 50-year wind using the annual maximum method or your Gummel distribution. Then you have a post-processing procedure where you did the correction to the standard condition, which you must always do is to convert to a height of 10 meters and a roughness length of 5 centimeters, and then the microscale generalization scheme with the linear computation model to obtain your mesoscale speed up factors from your upwind orography and your roughness length. Now this is what the outputs look from your selective downscaling method. That is your 1 in 50 a 10 minute wind at a 10 minute of 10 meters height over the roughness length of 5 centimeters and a horizontal resolution of 4 kilometers. Now, from that you must do your gust modeling, and we applied the Sears concept of the gust and estimation, where the basis is to model the air parcels deflected to the surface through turbulent eddies. And then you did your classical gust calculation with the wind converted to 10 meters through the application of a turbulence model to obtain the gust. We did a comprehensive paper on that, and that is the reference to the paper there at the bottom of the slide. I won't go into the technical details of that. So there's the gust estimations through the modeling. for the vines that you did. And if you do a comparison between the modeling for the 10 minutes, you can definitely see the increase in detail. And it also shows you that the interpolation of your measured data is not always sufficient. You know, if you look at the variation of the values from the modeled results and the lines on the map from the measured results. So what we did then was to take the modeled results and the measured results and look at where, because the measured results forms the basis of the map, where they are actually higher than the modeled results, because they take thunderstorms more explicitly into account. And then we increased those values and we came up with this map for 10 minutes. And we did basically the same procedure for your 1 in 50 year gust map.